So a quick recap. So we said in order to analyze investments, we can either do a fundamental analysis, which is more of understanding the background and the financial statements and the business model and the management of the company, which is for the long term. Or we can do technical analysis, which is short term, looking at the price and the volume to invest or trade in the short term. Now, in technical analysis, we said it's made up of charts. Let's look quickly at the types of chart. This is called a price chart. It only shows you one thing, shows only the closing price. So each one of these, this line is made up of prices connected. Each one of these is the closing price for that investment on that day. You can see here that this stock has an uptrend. It's going up. CISI might ask you, if we are measuring the movement of that investment across the years, what do you call it? You call that a primary movement. If we are measuring the movement across months, we call it the secondary movements. We don't have weeks, we have days. If we are measuring the movement of an investment every day, that's called a tertiary movement. Yes, we've seen the difference between primary, secondary, and tertiary sometimes comes in the exam. We'll also notice that CISI have spoken about other types of charts. You will not see these charts in the book. You will see their names. So we decided, you know what, let's just put some, give you the photos of these charts so you can understand them better. So CISI talks about the point and figure chart. This is how it looks. Every X shows an up movement. Every O shows a down movement. To be honest, this is not very popular type of chart. You can see it's not very easy to read. But in the exam, the only thing you need to know is a point and figure chart shows X and O's. An X is an up movement, and O is a down movement in the price.
For that day?
Well, it depends if it's a day or a month or a year.
They only ask this, what does X mean and what does O
mean? Yeah, that's why we put it for you. X is an upward movement, O is a downward movement. Looking at the bar charts, a bar chart is a bit better. Why? Because look at every bar. You see this bar, a bar gives you the opening price for that stock. Let's say the opening price was $3. And then during the session, it went all the way up to $5. It also went all the way down today to $2. And then it closed at $4. A single bar gives you four price points for every investment. It tells you what price it opened, the highest price it reached today, the lowest it reached, and what price it closed. That's why sometimes we call it OHLC, open, high, low, close. That's the bar chart. Now, it's a very, very popular type of chart. Now, this bar chart, if you connect these points like this, you get what we call a Japanese candlestick. Open, high, low, close. It gives you the highest points every day and the lowest and the opening and the close. A candlestick or a Japanese candlestick is very similar to a bar chart. It gives you the opening price, the close price, the highest point, and the lowest point. But you can notice that there is a white candle and there is a black candle. What's the difference between them? A white candle, look at the price. It opened at, let's say, $3, but it closed higher up. So that's a white candle. White or empty? Empty candle.
White candle closed.
It closed above the open. But if you look at the black one, it opened at $5 above, but it closed below. The black or the filled candle tells you that it closed below the opening price.
This candle in the exam?
What does it show? What does the candlestick tell you? Yes, sometimes it comes.
Mostly this question.
Candlesticks.
They love candlesticks. This is feedback from people who took the exam. Candlesticks are very popular. Good.
Whenever you say something,
so let's look at patterns. So let's look at this stock. This stock is going up and down. We draw this line to connect these points. This line is called the support line. Support line is the line that connects the stock movement at the bottom. And then we draw this line on top, this dotted line. We call this the resistance line. And you can see this stock is fluctuating within these two lines, resistance and support. But notice what happened here. What happened is that the stock, today, it penetrated the resistance line. It went out of it. This is a sign of continuation. Continuation means the stock is going to continue where it's going. It's going to continue going up. When a stock breaks the line, either above or below, we call that breakout. Breakout is when the stock moves out of the channel. And that is a sign of continuation, that the stock is going to continue where it's going. Obviously, if the stock breaks it down here, let's say the stock goes down here, that's also continuation downwards. So if it breaks support, it's going to go down. If it breaks resistance, it's going to go up.
Use a more breaking point.
We call it breakout. Breakout continuation. So a breakout is a type of, there are many continuation patterns.
What is it?
Resistance and support. So a breakout is a sign of continuation. There are many continuation patterns in investment, but in this qualification, we only study one continuation pattern, and here we are looking at breakout. Now, there are patterns, support.
Not on the other ones around that.
Yeah, so here, if it broke, if the stock broke this line, that means it's going to continue going down. Both. If you break resistance or if you break support, it's both breakout. Sometimes there are patterns, they don't show you continuation. They show you reversal. That means if the stock is going one side, it's going to reverse and go down. There are many types of reversal patterns. The most famous is the head and shoulders reversal pattern. It tells you the stock is going to reverse. Let's look at it here. So the stock is going up and then went down and then went up and then down and then went up. You notice we drew this support line. This is a support line. We drew it. And let's say the stock stopped here. Today it's here. We don't know where it's going to be tomorrow. But because this is support and history repeats itself, so both times, once it's touched the line, it jumped. Touched the line, it jumped. Touched the line, we expect it to jump. But if you are a technical analyst, you know this is the pattern of head and shoulders. And you know head and shoulders is a reversal pattern. So the stock is not going to go up. The stock is going to reverse. It's actually going to go down. In the exam, all you need to remember is, which of the following is a continuation pattern? Breakouts. Which of the following is a reversal pattern? Head and shoulders. You are breaking, now it's called the neckline. So once we talk about head and shoulders, we don't call it support line anymore. We call it neckline. Neckline is the reversal below the neckline going down. That's head and shoulders. So we said under investment analysis, there is technical analysis and fundamental analysis. We looked at technical analysis at the different types of charts quickly. Now, let's look at fundamental analysis. And let's go back to some mathematical formulas. I'm going to remind you, this is full of mathematics now. None of them comes as a formula, no. We're going to look at different ratios, debt ratios, liquidity ratios, investment ratios, profitability ratios, they're all there. No math. What CISI is going to ask you about in the exam is, what does this ratio tell you? How do we use this ratio? It's not the actual calculation. It's understanding what the ratio is all about. But before we look at the ratios, let's look at a quick, what is this called? Income statement. I drew the income statement for you because we notice sometimes in the exam, CISI loves to ask you about the different types of profits. Most of you know two profits, the gross profit, which is your sales minus your cost of sales, and they know the net profit, which is minus your expenses. Yes, but there are other types of profit also. Look at the gross profit minus your selling and admin expenses. You get what we call the EBITDA. the earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization. Once you remove depreciation and amortization from it, what are you left with? EBIT.
What is the amortization?
Depreciation for intangible assets. So after you remove depreciation and amortization, you are left with EBIT, sometimes called PIBIT, sometimes called operating profit. You will see any one of these three names in the exam. Once you remove the interest and tax, and then you get with the net earnings. Profit. P here stands for profit. Profit or earnings? Yeah. So earnings before interest and tax or profit before interest and tax? No. Ah, thank you. You reminded me of a question. Good. Why is EBITDA the most popular profitability number among investors globally? One of the answers was Suraya, is because there are no different names for it. It's the same name across all countries.
Yes.
One. But that's not the answer in the exam. Why do investors love all around the world? If you invest in Apple, US, and HSBC, UK, and then Deutsche Bank, Germany, if you invest in all of these countries, you are going to look at the EBITDA. You care about this more than you care about net profit. Why is EBITDA so important to investors?
Depreciation and
different countries.
Thank you. Accounting rules are different in different countries. So accounting rules will influence tax, interest, depreciation, and amortization. This will differ from country to country. So EBITDA, it gives you the profit before the influence of accounting. So you can compare EBITDA of different banks in different countries, but if you compare the net profit, be careful. These different countries have different accounting rules. So the net profit you are seeing, if you see a bank in the UK with small profit, it doesn't mean it did badly. Maybe the accounting system in the UK influenced that net profit. So in order to remove the influence of accounting, we go all the way up. We stop here, EBITDA. EBITDA gives you the purest profit before it's influenced by the different accounting standards around the world. So EBITDA is the most popular because it is least affected, not taxes, generally by accounting principles. That was actually a question in the exam.
Least affected by accounting
principles. Well, I think I misspelled principles. I think this is L-E. Principles. So now that we know how a normal income statement looks like, let's start talking about ratios. Why do we use ratios? Why do we use ratios?
Compare.
Thank you. To compare. Compare what?
Returns.
Not just that, but compare what to what?
Years.
In compare ourselves to last year and the year before, but also compare
with other companies.
Thank you. Compare us with other companies in the market. So ratios help us compare ourselves to the previous years and ourselves to our competitors. And there are different ratios. Ratios that talk about profit, ratios talk about debt, talk about liquidity. Liquidity is cash. And about investments. Let's start with the ratios. All of these maths, all of these ratios, you are not going to be required to calculate them. The only thing you need to understand is, what do we need this ratio for? What does it tell us? Return means profit. Profit on the capital. What does it tell you? How did the management use the capital to generate profit for the shareholders? Asset turnover. What does it tell you? It's look at sales and capital employed. How efficiently the company is using its assets to generate sales. Because as a company, you have assets. You bought the assets from the shareholders' capital. Okay, you have the assets. Very good. How are you using the factory? How are you using the buildings? How are you using all these assets to generate sales? You need to use them. And then you have the gross profit margin and the net profit margin, which are very, let's go back here. So the gross profit margin is the gross profit divided by sales, and the net profit margin is the net profit again, divided by sales. So investors like to look at both gross profit and net profit. Why? Because gross profit tells you the relationship between sales and cost of sales. Cost of sales is the cost that goes into the product. For example, cost of sales for iPhone is what? Material and labor to produce the phone. So if the gross profit is becoming worse and worse and worse, what is that telling Apple? Cost of production is high. The material is getting higher, inflation. They are paying higher salaries for labor. So the gross profit tells you there is a problem in production. Whereas if the net profit is getting worse, what does that tell you? Well, but it's mostly on the expenses. Salaries of employees, rent, electricity. You are paying too much interest on your bonds. Taxes are high. That's the expenses. So gross profit tells you what's happening with production. Net profit tells you what's happening with your overheads and expenses generally. That's the difference between them. So gross profit, you can see it here, gross profit margin, how management uses employees and raw materials in production. So if the gross profit is worse, that means your cost of production has gone up.
Net profit margin is high, that means,
if net profit is improving, that means your expenses, your overheads are improving, they're going down. Yeah, you are making more profit for every dollar of sale. just to remind you, you see sales, the other name for sales, revenue, turnover. These all mean the same thing, because you can see any of them in the exam, sales or revenue or turnover.
Is the return of capital is same like ROCE?
Of capital employed? Yeah. Same. Yeah, because you use your capital employed here. Yeah. Now, these are the profitability ratios. They tell you how much profit you are generating from using the assets, from using the capital of the company. But investors are also interested in debt ratios, because there are many investors, like, for example, Warren Buffett. One of the first things he looks at the company, how much debt the company has. If the company is doing extremely well, but it's under big debt, like, for example, AT&T in America, one of the oldest telecommunications companies, millions of people of customers. They're doing extremely well. But if you look at the balance sheet, you'll see so much debt. Some investors, they move away from that. So we have some ratios that tell us how much debt that company is in. There are two famous ratios, debt to equity. Some people call it the leverage ratio. So for many people, it's simple, just debt, your debt divided by your equity. Equity is the capital of the company. Obviously, if you have more equity than debt, that's very good. The bank will give you a loan because the bank knows if you collapse, they will take the equity. But if you have more debt than equity, then that means if this company collapses, there isn't enough capital to pay the creditors. So a high debt ratio is a sign that the company is in trouble. And no bank is going to give them a loan. And no investor is going to buy their bonds. Because they know if that company collapses, there is not enough equity or capital to pay them back. But in this qualification, yeah, we get to that point. So in this qualification, CISI decides to add not just debt, we add debt plus preference shares. You remember in chapter 3 when we said preference shares are like when ordinary shares marry debt bonds and they have a child, that's a preference shares. Because preference shares have the characteristic of bonds, of debt. They pay you a fixed coupon. Some of them are redeemable. And we treat preference shareholders aside, different than ordinary shareholders. So for many investors, they don't just look at debt. They actually put debt and preference shares because they consider themselves there's a priority to pay these people first before you pay the ordinary shares. Because this equity that you see here, this is equity for ordinary shareholders. So we need to look at when this company collapses, is that enough capital from ordinary shares to pay secured creditors, unsecured creditors, and preference shareholders, this equity for ordinary shares should be higher than this. If it's not, there is trouble somewhere. Because you have to pay off everybody before you pay the ordinary shareholders' equity. Because when we say equity, we mean ordinary shareholders' equity. It shows you the capital structure. In finance, what is the capital of a company? Capital is debt plus equity. So if you cannot issue shares and you want to grow your business, you borrow. So the debt structure shows you relationship between debt and equity. It shows you the structure, the capital structure of the company. Another famous ratio is the interest cover. Cover means, can I pay? Can I pay the interest on my loans to the bank? Look at it. It looks at your profit before interest and tax, and it divides it by the interest. Look at two companies, A and B. So A has profit before interest and tax, EBIT or EBITDA. A has $1 million, or let's say $100,000 of profit. B has $10,000 of profit. Which one is a better company? Okay, let's look at the interest. A has interest to pay every year $50,000. B has interest to pay $1,000. Which one is the better company? Why? Because A can only pay the interest twice, whereas B can pay the interest for 10 years. This is what we call the interest cover. How many times can you cover your interest payments? B can cover its interest payments 10 years or 10 times. So the interest cover is how many times can you pay the interest? Do you have enough profit to pay the interest? Yes, company B's profit is $10,000. It has to pay interest on loans $1,000. So it can pay the interest 10 times. Every year, 1,000, 1,000, 1,000. So its profit, it's 10 times the interest. This is good. Whereas company A's profit is 100,000. But their interest payment every year is $50,000. So they can only cover their interest payments for 2 years. And this is bad. So you need higher interest cover. But you need lower leverage ratio. You need lower debt to equity. So this should be low, this should be high. So these are debt ratios. Let's look at liquidity ratios. So the ordinary shareholders' equity. Yeah. We divide it by ordinary shareholders. It's not part of the ordinary shareholders' equity.
So they own shares.
Yeah, but it's not. Here we're dividing it by ordinary shareholders' equity. Usually.
So is there any rule, general rule for all the companies that they should have at least, you know, 2 times or 3 times of the interest
cover? No, you compare it to the industry. Huh? You compare it to the industry.
Industry.
So if we look at the airline industry, and all of them have 5 times interest cover, but your airline has 2 times interest cover, your airline is not doing well. So that's why we use ratios to compare to the peers in the industry. Now let's look at liquidity ratios. These are ratios that tell you if the company has enough liquidity. Profit is nice. Think of the company as a human body. Profit is the muscles. Bigger, stronger muscles means that you're a bigger, stronger company. But if profit is the muscle, cash is the blood. You cannot live without cash. You cannot live without blood. You can live without muscles. You can survive without muscles, without profit. It's fine. Amazon was making a loss for 20 years. Twitter for 15 years. They're making losses. Investors were happy. Why? Because they still have cash. Liquidity. For many investors, they first look at liquidity when they invest. So there are 3 or 4 ratios for liquidity. Let's start with the first one. It's called the current ratio. In the current ratio, we divide our current assets by our current liabilities. Assets are what we own. Our current assets are the following. Cash plus, do you know what receivables is? People have to pay us. Our money in the market, people have to pay us. Sometimes they call it debtors. So cash plus receivables plus stocks, inventory, goods in the warehouse. These 3 are what we call the current assets. Cash plus receivables plus stocks. If we add all of these together, do we have enough to pay our current liabilities? Current liabilities are like short-term debts. Now, of course, they need to be more than the current liabilities. So this ratio needs to be over 1. It needs to be higher than 1 so that you are doing well. If it's lower than one, it means your current assets are less than your liabilities. It means you don't have enough cash to pay your short-term commitments. Some people would say, well, what if I am a bank? I don't have inventory. I don't have stocks in my warehouse. I am a bank. We don't have goods. We can't use the current ratio. So we have to remove this stocks and inventory. Once you remove the stocks and inventory, you have what we call the liquidity ratio. Liquidity ratio, same thing. It's just that it's the cash and the receivables without stocks, because not all businesses have inventory and goods and stocks. Stocks here means goods, bada. So in Arabic. So the liquidity ratio is your current assets, but without your stocks and inventory. Do you have enough cash and receivables only without stocks? Do you have enough cash and receivables only to pay your commitments? And then some people say, well, what if there is no stocks and inventory? And what if none of our customers pay us back? Or everybody defaults? The cash we currently have, is it enough to pay our commitments? That is called the cash ratio. So the cash ratio talks only about cash. Do you have enough cash to pay your commitments? Assuming that your goods are not sold and your customers do not pay you. Do you have enough to pay your current liabilities? The question in the exam would be, which of the following ratios is the strictest? It's the cash ratio. Honestly, it's unfair. Because you are assuming no customer will pay. You are assuming no goods in the warehouses will be sold. It's too much. So the cash ratio is the strictest. And you see here, it should not be used by itself. It should always be combined with other liquidity ratios. Don't judge a company only on the cash ratio. Because most companies have receivables in the market and customers sometimes pay. And the fourth ratio is called the Z-score, invented by Dr. Altman in the 70s, I think. It's a number. The number can either be positive number, that means higher than zero, or it can be a negative number, that is lower than zero. If the Z-score is higher than zero, this company has enough cash and liquidity. Go ahead and invest in it. If the company has negative Z-score analysis, that means its Z-score is below zero, this company might be going bankrupt soon. Because it doesn't have enough cash, this company might be insolvent. So the Z-score is a number. If it's positive, that means this company has liquidity. If it's negative, this company doesn't have liquidity. Yeah, Z-score sometimes comes. A Z-score of minus 0.3, what does that tell you? Insolvent, the company is insolvent, yeah. Now let's look at some investment ratios. So let's say you've looked at the profitability of the company. You've looked at the debt of the company. You've looked at the liquidity of the company. Now, we need to look at the investment ratios. We need to invest in this company. Is it a good investment or not? Are you with us? Okay. Let's write. Company A and Company B. Company A has $100,000 of profit. This is net profit. And Company B has $10,000 of net profit. Which one would you invest in? Company A has net profit of $100,000 and Company B of $10,000. Okay.
What's that meaning?
Let's see. Let's say the number of shares in the market of Company A. Company A has 1,000 shares in the market. 100,000 shares in the market. And Company B has 1,000 shares in the market. If you buy one share of Company A, how much profit will you get? So $1 per share, right? Whereas for Company B, so which one is the better company now? Company B. This is what we call the earnings per share. How much earnings, how much profit every share gets. So if Company A's net profit is $100,000, and Company B's profit is $10,000, don't judge yet. The number of shares in the market for Company A is 100,000 shares. That means every share gets $1 of profit. Whereas B has 1,000 shares. $10,000 over 1,000 shares, every share will get $10 of profit. So obviously Company B is the better investment, because every share I buy gets me $10. But with company A, every share I buy gets me $1. So which one is the better investment? Let's see. So we now know how much every company will give us in profit. That's the earnings per share, which is this. The next point is, well, okay, I know how much I'm going to earn, but I need to buy the share. What's the price of the share? How much am I going to pay for it? Let's look at the price. Let's assume the price of company A is $5, whereas the price of company B is $100.
Before we go to the 500, if I buy 10 shares of company A, not get the same $10.
Yeah.
We're not getting the same
$10. Yeah, but if you buy 10 shares of B, you'll earn $100.
But here's 100, here's 1,000. Extra, I buy extra to make the same.
Yeah, but now you'll buy with what? With cash? How much is the price?
$1.
No, this is the earnings, how much you earn. The earnings of the company. So the price of every share of company A is $5. That's what you're going to pay. You pay $5, you get profit of $1. Whereas with company B, the price per share is $100. You pay $100, you get $10. Which one is the better company?
A.
Why A?
Paying less.
Thank you. Because A, the share is 5 times more expensive than the profit. Whereas with B, the share price is 10 times more expensive.
We can make it as a percentage, like...
Yeah, but this one, we use it as X. So this is called the price over earnings. The price over earnings, the PE ratio. I am paying for every $5 in A, I get $1. In B, for every $100, I get $10 only. So... In B, I need 10 years to recoup my $100 investment. In A, I need 5 years to recoup my investment. So A is back to be the better investment. That's the PE ratio. I know it sounds a lot, but once you go through it again through the videos, we will repeat it. So let's go through. So we've done with the earnings per share and the price per share. But let's go through it again and let's clear the screen. So let's say there are two companies, A and B, and we need to invest in either one, either A or B, but we don't know which one to invest in yet. Company A's profit is $100,000. Company B's profit is $10,000. So this $100,000 is going to be is the shareholders, but I am a shareholder. How many shares do I have? This is very important. Now, in the market, company A, number of shares in the market is 100,000 shares. This $100,000 of profit will be distributed to 100,000 shares. How much will every share get?
$1
of profit for every share. Company B has $10,000 of profit. It's going to be distributed among 1,000 shares. How much will every share get? $10 per share. So now company B looks better because every share gets more profit. We call this earnings per share. How much every share is earning? With A, every share is earning $1. With company B, every share is earning $10. But that's not the end of the story, because before we get these earnings, we have to buy the share. We have to pay for it. What's the price of the share? Company A, the price is $5. So I'm going to pay $5 and I'm going to earn $1. How many years will it take me to recoup my investment? 5 years. $1, $1, $1, $1, $1. After 5 years, I get back my $5. So it's going to take me 5 years. I am paying 5 times for every dollar of profit. Whereas with company B, the share price in the market is $100. If I invest $100 today, and every year it gets me $10, how many years will it take me to get back my capital?
Yeah.
10 years. $10, $10, $10 for 10 years. It's going to take me 10 times more. So company B is more expensive because I need more time to get back my money. Company A is better. This 5 times and 10 times is what we call the PE ratio. It tells you how expensive a company is.
The lower, the more expensive.
Thank you. But not to all investors. Because you are going to learn in chapter 6 that sometimes investors actually go for these expensive companies. Why?
Because immediately maybe you will make more profit.
Why would an investor actually... Amazon, Apple, their PE ratio is 50, 60 times. Some of these tech companies, 70 times. It's going to take you 70 years. Growth. That's the word. Higher PE ratio, higher growth expected. And usually tech companies are expected to grow faster. That's why people are willing to pay more for them. This is the question you'll get in a PE ratio. What does the PE ratio? If you are looking for growth, but it's risky, it's expensive.
Somehow.
Oh, that's the word, overvalued. But for some investors, they will go for it. Because some tech companies can be overvalued for 20, 30 years ahead. Some investors are fine with it. That's called growth investing. You'll see that in chapter 6. More. Dividend yield. Now we said the company makes $100,000 of profit or $10,000 of profit, but not all of the profit is actually transferred to the investors. The company keeps some of that profit and then transfers a part of it. So as an investor, yes, it's important to me to know how much profit the company is making. That's good. I need to know how much profit per share. That's good. But I actually want to know the dividend, how much is going to come to my pocket. Because not all of the profit is distributed. So the dividend yield tells me how much dividend is going to be transferred. So if two companies, A and B, A is distributing dividend of $2, whereas B is distributing dividend of $5, which one is the better one?
Five.
Why? How much did you pay for it? Let's say the price of A is $10, whereas the price of B is $100. So you're going to earn 5% of dividend here, and you're going to earn how much? 2% of dividend here. So your yield, your dividend yield here in company A is better because the actual dividend given to you is 5% of your investment. Whereas in company B, it's only 2% of your investment. That's dividend yield.
Yield in this case?
Just like the flat yield in bonds. What is the flat yield in bonds? Coupon over price. In stocks, dividend over price. In bonds, coupon over price. Coupon is the distribution of the bond. In the stocks, what is distribution? Dividend. Dividend over price.
Let's say after 5%
coupon. Where?
Dividend.
Oh, this is 20%, right?
The dividend name is 5%.
So this is 20%.
40%.
If I invest $10 and I earn $2 every year, I am making $20. 20%. Price is 2 here. No, forget about this. So this is the new price. So $10 of price, and I'm going to earn $2, so I'm going to make 20% of my investment.
Another one,
5%. And in here, another one is 5%. Yeah, I'm sorry. So another one is 5% here. So I'm going to invest $100. I'm going to get $5 every year, so I'm going to earn $5 of cash coming into my pocket. That's my dividend. So obviously, investment A is better because for every $10, I make 20%. That's the dividend yield. Dividend is just like how much you are going to earn in cash. Yeah, for the yield in bonds. Do you know the yield in bonds? What is the yield in bonds?
Coupon divided by par.
You are not with me. Are you with me? What is the yield in bonds? If you go and sell a bond to the customer and you tell him the yield is 5%, what does that mean?
The coupon.
Coupon divided by the price, how much he's going to pay. So if it's 5%, that means if he pays 100 dirhams or $100, how much will he get? $5. If another bond is 7% yield, he's going to earn more. That's the yield. How much is he going to earn? Cash, dividend per share, he's going to earn $5 per share, and the price is $100. So here, he's going to earn 5%. If another company, another bond, another share is 7%, that means the other share is going to give him more cash, more yield, more dividend. That's good. Many companies, the dividend yield is announced. Company A's dividend yield is 5%. Company B dividend yield is 7%. That's good. But the problem is, remember in debt, when we go back to debt, we looked at interest cover. How many times can a company cover its interest? We said company B can cover the interest payment 10 times. Why? Because the company B's profit is $1,000 and it has to pay interest $1,000. So it can cover the interest payment 10 years. That's interest cover. It can cover the interest 10 times. Same thing for dividends. If it has $10,000 of profit, and from the $10,000 of profit, it distributes $1,000 in dividend, how many times can it distribute dividend? 10 years. That's the dividend cover. I'm going to repeat. Dividend cover, what is your profit? Your earnings? I am earning for every share $10 of profit. And I distribute for every share $1 in dividend. So I can distribute 10 years of dividend. That is called the dividend cover. How many years I can cover or distribute dividends? The higher the dividend cover tells me I have lots of profit and I can cover my dividend distributions for many years to come. So it's the earnings per share divided by the dividends per share. How many times can my earnings cover my dividends?
This is for that,
Yes. So if my earnings per share are $10 and I am distributing dividends to my investors of $1, that means I can 10 times cover this distribution. I can transfer this year, I can transfer next year, and next year, and next year, and next year, because my profit is 10 times the dividend. Dividends are distributed from profit. If I have $10 of profit and this year I distribute $1, I can distribute for 9 extra years.
Next year will have
how much? That's a different thing. So a higher dividend cover tells you this company has enough profit to cover its dividend distributions. More. Price to book. What does book mean here? What does price mean? In this exam, if you see the word price, it's always market price.
Book price is market price?
No. When you see price, market price. Book means book price. What is, thank you. Not just face value. Sometimes, you remember net asset value from funds, which is total assets minus total liabilities, gives you the net assets. So the company calculates the share price in its books. Total assets minus total liabilities. So according to our books, the price, the net asset value is $1. But the share price in the market is $5, and that's completely normal because the price of a share in the market is always higher than the price of the share in the books. So here, the price of the share in the market is 5 times higher than the book. 5. This is completely normal. Some people say, oh, I need a stock that has a low ratio. That means the price in the market is, let's say, 3. And the price in the book is 1. So the price in the market is closer to the price in the book. Some people look for that. It tells you that the stock is cheap. But it's a sign. It's a warning sign. If a stock drops less than 3, if this ratio becomes less than 3, it tells you that this stock is incredibly cheap. There is a reason a stock is cheap. There is a reason anything is cheap. Why? People don't want it. If it's cheap, people are dumping it. If the PB ratio, the price to book ratio, the market price to the book price is low, it tells you the market has thrown the stock away. Nobody wants it. Don't get, oh, this is a valuable stock. Oh, let me buy it now. It's cheap. There's a reason it's cheap. If this ratio is less than 3, it means that the company is undervalued. It might be an opportunity for you to buy, but keep in mind, there's a reason it's cheap. Because there are hundreds of millions of investors who are not buying it. That's why the market price is low. So be careful before you enter into that investment. Continuing with the final page. That's the last page. So some people say, well, just like with property, I can value my property from the rent I get. I can value the property from the rent I get. If I have a house and I rent it for $10,000, I'm gonna keep it for 5 years. So $10,000, $10,000 for 5 years, I'm gonna earn $50,000. Maybe that gives me an idea about how much this house is valued at. Mr. Gordon says the same thing. Mr. Gordon says, I can value a stock, just like a house, from the income it gets me. A house gets me rent, a stock gets me dividend. Same thing for bonds. Some bonds are valued from the coupon they get. So you are able to value a stock from the dividend it gets you. That is called the growth, the Gordon formula. Look at what it says. Let's say a stock gives you a dividend every year of $2 in dividend. And this company is growing the dividends. By the way, you know, there are companies, we call them the dividend aristocrats. A dividend aristocrat is a company, not only do they distribute dividend every year, but they grow it. First year they give you $2, next year $3, next year $4. Some companies like Coca-Cola, McDonald's, they are 100 years old, and they grow the dividend every year. These are called dividend aristocrats. So this company pays me dividend $2, but it also grows the dividend every year by 5%. I need one third thing. I need what is my required return. As an investor, every investor has a required return. If I'm going to invest in a stock, I need the stock to get me at least 15% every year. If it's not going to get me 15%, I will move my money, I'll put it in property. I'll move it, I'll put it in deposits. My required rate of return is 15%. Any investment that doesn't get me 15%, I'll move it, I'll put it in a bank. So once you have these three numbers, the dividend the company is paying you, the growth, the company is growing the dividend by 5% every year, and you as an investor have a required return of 15%, excellent. Once you have these three numbers, you are able to calculate the price of the share, the fair price of the share. Mr. Gordon says it's simple, $2, the dividend, divided by my required rate of return, 15%, minus the dividend growth, 5%. So $2 over 10%, that's $20. So Mr. Gordon says the fair price of this share is $20. If you go to the market and you find it for $17, buy it, because it's cheap. The fair value is $20. If you go to the market, you find it for $30, don't buy it. It's too expensive. The fair value is $20. How did we get the $20? We look at how much dividends we're getting from it. And based on this in cash inflows, we arrived at $20. Thank you. That's chapter 6. That is the capital asset pricing model calculation.
Dividend growth is the growth of dividend which they are making every year.
Yeah, so if it's $2 this year, next year is 2.1, 2.2, 2.3. Every year grows by 5%. That's the Gordon growth model. It's a very famous model, by the way, in finance.
What is the NAV?
No, no, $20? This is the fair, this is the fair price in the, to buy. Buy it for $20. If you find it in the market for $18, buy it. If you find it for $30, don't buy it because it's too expensive. Yeah, it's overpriced. And finally, before I move on, the final 2 points, economic value added and market value. These 2 points are rare in the exam, but let's explain it quickly. What is economic value? People say, if I'm going to invest in a company, it better make profit. Some investors say, no, I don't care about profit. Look at Amazon, it was losing money for 20 years. Look at Twitter, losing money for 15 years. There are many, many ways a company can create value for you as an investor without making profit. It can grow the assets, for example. It can grow the equity, for example. It can grow its market share, for example. There are so many ways companies can create value for you without making profit. This formula, economic value added, EVA, is the number that tells you that. If the EVA is positive, it tells you that the company has created value for you as a shareholder. If the EVA is negative, it tells you the company has destroyed value. You as a shareholder have lost value. There's no formula here. You just have to understand what it is. What is the EVA? Well, some people will say, good, I can calculate the EVA for the next 5 years. So if I have in year one, in year two, in year three, four, and five, I can calculate the EVA for the first year and the second year and the third year and the fourth year and the fifth year. I can calculate the annual EVA. If I add them all together, I get the market EVA or the market value added. So the market value added is the sum of the future EVAs. And if you get a question, it's only going to be, what's the difference between the market value and the economic value? The market value is the sum of all of the EVAs into the future.